got cold energies today.
All right, we will be reading Mark 1:21-28 and Deuteronomy 18:15-20. Then they went into Capernaum, and right away he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and began to teach. They were astonished at his teaching because, unlike the scribes, he was teaching them as one having authority. Just then, a man with an unclean spirit was in their synagogue. He cried out, "What do you have to do with us, Jesus Nazarene? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him and said, "Be quiet and come out of him." And the unclean spirit convulsed him, shouting with a loud voice, and came out of him. Then they were all amazed, so they began to argue with one another, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." His fame then spread throughout the entire vicinity of Galilee. "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own brothers. You must listen to him. This is what you requested from the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, 'Let us not continue to hear the voice of the Lord our God or see this great fire any longer, so that we will not die.' Then the Lord said to me, 'They have spoken well. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command him. I will hold accountable whoever does not listen to my words that he speaks in my name. But the prophet who dares to speak in my name a message I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet must die.'" This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
May be seated. I admit that this is a sermon that's not always easy to speak about, and oftentimes I'll be reading a scripture, and pretty soon after that, when I'm reading, something will just pop into my head, and I say, "Man, that'll make an awesome sermon. That'll be wonderful." Today's scripture wasn't like that at all. It was when I was preparing this sermon a few weeks ago, I read it again. And at first, it really didn't speak to me that much. And I said, "Well, Lord, why in the world am I talking about something when I have no idea what you want me to say?" So then a few nights later, I was kind of half asleep there watching TV with Lindsay. A lot of times I'll fall asleep in the chair and she'll be watching something that I'm not particularly interested in. And just so happens that that night was one of those nights. And Lindsay wanted to see this documentary. And it was on the Brack Davidians out of Waco. And it was a documentary about them, and somehow or another, in my half-asleep state, this scripture popped back into my head. And, I'm one of these types that I like to mull something around for a while before I talk about it, and I began to wonder to myself, I said, "Man, maybe I'm supposed to be talking about something like this." But then I thought, well, how in the world does this have anything to do with my scripture today? And I began to listen a little bit more earnestly to the documentary that Lindsay was watching. And I started to wonder myself in my head, I said, how in the world could this many people be fooled by a guy that looks like he belonged in a 70s sitcom? And I watched this 2020 special or whatever it was. I'm not sure it was 2020. But anyway, it was one of those programs, these news programs that you watch in the evening. Still half asleep, but it occurred to me that these people had several opportunities to survive. They had several opportunities to catch this guy without anybody at all being harmed. And I began to think about that for a little bit. And I read this Old Testament text again, and it started to talk to me a little bit. In the scripture today, it says that God says, "I will give the people a prophet." And then he later says that anyone who speaks without having my word or speaks about other gods, that person is going to die. Now, I realized that there was a bunch of innocent people that had nothing to do with this at all, especially children who died during that raid. And there's still those people that live out there to this day. But when I reread that text, what stood out to me is that these false prophets that exist, see, false prophets do exist, and they exist everywhere. Even though you have God's word, there are still those who are going to try to lead us astray. And there are those who think that God is speaking to them, but these prophets have one thing against them. They have no authority. They are doomed to die. Now, I'm not really saying that it was God's will for all these people in that compound to die, but I'm saying that there were several opportunities for them to humble themselves and to say, it doesn't have to come to this. It doesn't have to come to all this death. And me and Lindsay were talking the other night about a subject that that tends to get me every once in a while. We're talking about evil in the world. In fact, it came from a Grey's Anatomy episode, if anybody watched a Grey's Anatomy in here. We were watching the episode from the other night, and me and Lindsay ended up having a discussion, a philosophical discussion out of a Grey's Anatomy episode. Go figure. But anyway, we were talking about evil existing in the world. And the person that happened to be the star of that particular show was having a really tough time. And she was a Christian doctor, and she considered, she was having a crisis of faith, so to speak, at that particular moment. And I thought about it for a minute, and I said, you know what? Evil exists in this world, and it is all around us. And we as people, we really have no control over that evil. It happens. It's going to happen no matter where we're at and what we're doing. But God gives those people, certain people, authority that help to handle these situations, like doctors in crises and police officers, people like that, people that go in and do good for others. Those people have the authority to help fight evil. Us in this church, we have the authority just by going out and talking about God and proclaiming His Word. We have the authority because God gives us that authority as Christians to tell everyone about Him. To tell everyone about Him. So let's look at our New Testament text for a minute. See, Jesus is teaching in the synagogue. And what are all these people saying as He's teaching? They said, well, where did this man come from that speaks with such authority like no other? Even the demons recognized who Jesus is and the authority that He has. The demons even scared of what Jesus is going to do to him. And then everyone marvels at this because Jesus has authority over the scriptures and even over the demons. And the reason that Jesus has this authority, we talked about this in children's church a minute ago, is that God gave Him this authority. His authority comes from His Father. And what makes it so special is that He doesn't presume that He has this authority on His own, and that His authority is His own, and He has all this great power and this great strength to do this stuff. But He owns up to the fact that this authority was given to Him by His Father. By God. And I want to tell you guys something. When I prepare a sermon, I tend to write my sermons out for the most part because it's easier for me, because if I take notes, I'll forget something really important. I promise I will. So I tend to write my sermons out as I'm preparing them. And I pray most every single time before I do these sermons, my prayer is always that, Lord, let the words that I write and the words that I say be the words that You want heard. Not my own message, but Yours. Because as pastors, we need guidance too. See, here on earth, no one has authority unless it is given to them by God. And we don't ask to be anything like God, but we do ask to be used as His humble servants and for His will to be done, not our own. Why would Jesus be able to cast out a demon? Where would His strength come from? Why would He be able to do this? His strength and His authority comes from God. And what makes it so wonderful is even though He knows that He has this authority, He does it with such a humble, humble way and a humble, humble attitude. I want you guys to notice something about what happened when Jesus commanded this demon to come out. the demon was wanting to scream out, I know who you are, I know where you come from, I know you're the Messiah. But Jesus did something. He silenced that demon. He told the demon to be quiet. And it took a long, long time further on in the book of Mark for them to actually have a conversation to where we find out and the disciples will finally say, in fact, Peter says, you are the Messiah. You come from God. And then after that, Jesus does it again. He says, well, look, you guys know this, but I want you guys to keep this to yourselves. Why is it that he doesn't want him to be recognized? He wants his identity kept a secret. Why would he want that? Why would he not want people to scream and shout and say, you are Jesus, you are the Messiah, you're the one that's here to lead us? I think that partially it is because he didn't want the public to know who he was, because he was afraid that if they found out who he was, that they would then not want to send him to the cross. And Jesus did not need these people to identify him. He knew where his strength came from. He knew that his authority came from God, and he used it only to glorify God. Most any times that he did a healing or anything like that, he always glorified God when he did it. He didn't do it for his own selfish purposes. He did this always to glorify the Father, to glorify God. And so it occurred to me, most of the time when you see these cult leaders and these people who are false prophets and those, I see one thing on their minds. The one thing that they all want is they all have their own selfish wants and desires put forward in front of their teaching. They want power. They want control. They want to be over people. They want to have their own authority. Jesus wanted none of that. Every time that he performed a miracle, every time that he cast out a demon, every time that he did just about anything, he did it in the name of God. He was willing to give all of his power that he knew that he had, all this authority that he knew he had, all of this stuff, he was willing to give it up in order to obey what his Father had asked him to do. He humbled himself. He submitted himself to human authorities. When all he had to do was say, Lord, I don't want to do this. Father, save me from this. This isn't where I want to be. He did it, even though he knew he didn't have to. You know, when I was growing up, and even up to a few years ago, I wanted to be a powerful person. I always wanted to be rich and famous and have all this wonderful fame, and I'd see all these movie stars and stuff like that, and all the girls around them. I'd think, man, why couldn't I have that life? That would be wonderful. I would enjoy that. I think it'd be a lot of fun, driving around in a super sports car or pulling up to the red carpet on a limo and getting out. I think it'd be fun. Why are y'all laughing about that? It's not that funny, I promise. But I realize that if I was chasing these selfish thoughts and these selfish wants and these selfish desires, I was going to lose myself. I was going to lose my life. Now, while it might be fun for a little while, fame is always fleeting, right? Fame always comes to an end. Riches can go away in a minute. If you have a lot of money in the stock market, you can turn around and one day it can be high and the next day it can be gone. Things happen. And those selfish desires that I had for my life were making me lose myself and making me lose my own way. I found something that was greater than all that, that was more amazing and more wonderful than any of those selfish desires and all those wonderful things that I really wanted and all that gold and all that greatness. I found peace. And you know what? That peace, to me, is worth way more than being rich, than being famous, than having all the girls, than having the wonderful lifestyle. That peace is a peace that only God gives. And it is an amazing peace. And it's wonderful. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm satisfied, that I want to sit here and say, okay, I've got everything I want, I'm wonderful. Because it's not the way that God wants it. He wants us to continue to grow the kingdom. He wants us to continue to get out there and beat doors and bring people to Him. But I do know one thing. I know that submitting to the will of God and submitting to His authority is the best way to have peace. And it's amazing and it's a wonderful feeling. And I hope that every one of you have that today. That peace is so great that it overcomes anything that you could possibly get from this world. Let's pray. Our most precious and heavenly Father, this morning we come to you to say thank you. Thank you for offering that peace to us. Lord, lift us up as we go through this new day, this new week, and strengthen and guide us always. For it's in your holy and precious name I pray. Amen. As we come to our closing psalm today, I want everyone to know that this altar is always open. It's always open for anyone. And if you need special prayer, I'm here for you. It's always available and always open. Let us sing the closing hymn. It's a wonderful closing song. Let's stand. Thank you for all that you are and for all that you do. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.